better. Happy 4th of July. Happy Independence Day. Just think, we could be living like we're Russians, but we're not. Kathy's got a couple quick announcements. Just hold on a moment and she'll be right with us.
Good morning. Well, the week is finally upon us. The grand opening of Trinity Farmers Market. I have some flyers here that Nicole Inchko made for us. If you would take one and pass it back, I'm going to pass them throughout the service here. And she did a beautiful job. Nicole is doing our Facebook page. Also, there is a meeting for all the volunteers between Sunday school and church. And we'll explain the farmers market. It's very easy for the volunteers. If you haven't volunteered yet, you can still volunteer. So we look forward to it. Thank you. In 201.
Meetings in 201. Anybody have anything else that we need to put out? Everything else is in the bulletin this week. Okay, we're going to be marching the colors in. When we march the colors in, I just ask that everybody stand up. And then we're going to do our national anthem. And then we'll get into our service. Thank you.
If everybody could please stand.
Good.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Trinity United Methodist Church. We're delighted that you've come to worship with us this morning. I want you to turn to your neighbor, look at them in the eye, and ask them whether or not they take mustard or ketchup on their hot dog. Well, good morning, everyone. Today is the day before the 4th. I'm sure many of you are celebrating today and tomorrow. Thursday is the start of the farmer's market. So what's the big deal about the farmer's market? The farmer's market is our church's biggest effort this year at reaching out to our community. We will be offering them, among other things, a prayer tent. But what we want is we want our community to come together, and we want to offer opportunities for us to get to know people so that in time we can share the gospel with them. That's why we're doing this. We're not doing this just to make ourselves busy. We're doing this in the hope that we can share the gospel with those people who are without it. Are you with me? Say amen.
Amen.
That was kind of weak and limp. If you're with me, say amen.
Amen.
All right, very good. Now, let's allow ourselves to be centered by Pat, and then we'll begin worship together.
Good morning. Welcome to all those who are here this morning and all those who are watching on live stream. Please hear the call to worship. God called America for a great and noble purpose. Government of the people, by the people, and for the people. Around the world, the experiment in democracy is threatened by tyrants and ideologues alike. Worse, there are threats within our country from fanatics, extremists, anarchists, and most dangerous of all, those who are indifferent. The strength of our democracy is in an informed, educated, and God-fearing citizenry. So may we do our part and commit ourselves to serving as active and informed citizens, devoted to the principle that out of many, one nation shall thrive for the benefit of all. Let us stand and sing our opening hymn, America, which is found on page 697.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Join me in the prayer of confession. Lord, may we make an idol of our country and its flags. May we never be mindful. You and you alone are our first and most precious commitment. To you we bow first. Forgive us when we confuse patriotism with godliness and democracy with the gospel. Lord, forgive us when we love our country threatens to eclipse our love of you. Amen. Please join me in silent prayer. Amen. The Lord loves America, but God's love has nothing to do with democracy, a free press, or the belief that all men and women are created equal. God loves America because it is the Lord's nature to love, forgive, and be gracious. So in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Christ, I am forgiven. Amen.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning's first Bible reading is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 to 23. Please follow along in the Pew Bible on page 1856 or in your Bible. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who have not obtained mercy, but have obtained mercy. Living before the world. Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Submission to the government. Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors as those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Submission to the masters. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. For this is commendable. If because of conscience towards God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully, for what credit is it if, when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffers for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. Who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth? Who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return? When he suffered, he did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously. May God add his blessing to the reading of this word.
Good morning. Good morning. Sorry, I was caught up in the word. We've come to that time in our service today where we can lift up our prayer concerns, our praises, and where have we seen God at work today as we celebrate the birth of our nation. It just makes me a little weepy. I know that surprises you. Okay, let's go. Let's hear your prayer concerns and your praises.
Franklin Myers, Sunday evening when Cindy and I came home from a glorious dance at the pastor's house, her and I got a phone call from the state police in Bedford County. Apparently, my daughter is being sexually molested by my ex-wife's boyfriend. So I asked that you keep her, Isabella Ann Myers is her name, you keep her in the prayer list. And also, I'd like to pray for Cindy, who is not with us today. She's under the weather and really stressful. So on a good note, though, my daughter had to go to foster care. So I praise God that the foster parents they go to church and they're Christians and they're looking out for her. So praise God.
Very good. Thank you, Franklin.
Jenny Jones here. And I just ask for prayer for our country, that we could be unified and work together as we should.
Thank you, Jenny.
This is Leonard Trett. I would like you to hold up Mara Jenkins in your prayers. Mara had surgery for cancer last fall, and she's under treatment now. And she's a strong, believing lady, and she would covet our prayers on her behalf. And so I ask that you would do that. She was a little uncomfortable with me making the announcement because she didn't want somebody in Trinity to think that her name gets on the prayer list because she's the secretary. That's not the way it works. I explained that to her. But do remember, Mara, she's a little uneasy, as you might expect, and she does need our prayers.
Thank you, Leonard.
John Briner here. I just have a prayer that safe travel for my brother coming home from vacation in Florida. Safe travel. Thank you.
Nancy Schiff, I have a praise. Rich and I were honored yesterday to go to Charlie Musser's memorial service. What a testimony for his life. There was probably over 200 people there at McBick, and it was just a touching service, and we were honored.
Thank you, Nancy. Seeing no others, would you bow your heads with me, please? Merciful Father, we just thank you and praise you, first of all, that we live in this country with our freedoms, and Lord, with all the craziness going on, we are still a free nation, and we thank you for those that have fought for that. We pray, Lord, that you would be with Bella, Lord, as she is going through a very difficult time right now. We ask that you'd be with Franklin and with Cindy as they try to support her. And Lord, it can be very stressful, but I pray that you will take that anxiety away from them and just help them to be supportive during this time. We lift up our country, Lord, that we would be unified, that we would work together for the common good. We pray for Mara, Lord, our secretary who so faithfully comes in here and works diligently to get these things done and keep us up to date. We just pray that you'll be with her treatments, that they would be successful. We're so grateful, Lord, for Peg Bricker's surgery went well, and Lord, we just ask you to be with her during the healing. Please be with our friend David, who has been missing for a couple weeks, Lord. He needs our prayer, so we lift him up to you as well. Please be with John's brother as he travels. Give him traveling mercies, as there's so many traveling this weekend. And Lord, we pray that Charlie Musser's service was so wonderful, Lord, that he was ushered into heaven. And we pray for George Yearling as well, Lord. You know the needs here, and we just pray that you would meet them. What a privilege it is to be able to bring these things to you, Lord. And we just thank you for hearing them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, you supplied our needs. You confound us. You never fail. You always come through. We have all sorts of fears and anxieties about not having enough, but you have never failed to supply our need. And we pray, Lord, that our church would never fail to supply the spiritual needs of our community. We pray, Lord, that we would not just feed people vegetables and fruits at our farmer's market, but by this farmer's market, we would somehow be able to offer prayer and encouragement and community and our witness to what you can do. Lord, we ask that you would help us to be a blessing to those who are without you. In your name and by your spirit, we give you thanks, Lord. Amen.
This morning's second Bible lesson is from 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. Please follow along in your pew Bible on page 673. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. May God add his blessing to the reading of this word.
Can you hear me back there, Larry? You can hear me. All right. This is a medley of songs you all know. For spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains' majesties, above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed your grace on thee. And crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Jesus, keep me near the cross.
There a flowing fountain, free from all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory. Till this rapture its all shall find rest beyond the river. Oh, beautiful, four heroes prove. In liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than I, America, America, may God thy gold refine. Till success be nobleness, and every gain divine. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flow be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure. Oh, beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster city gleam, undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed your grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Let's bow our heads. Lord, we love you. We give you thanks and praise. We ask that now your word, not our word, not our opinion, not the thoughts of the majority. No, Lord, thy word would be proclaimed, the gospel, your gospel. Bless these words, Lord, in the meditations of our hearts. In your wonderful and precious name we pray. Amen. I can think of one particular building in the United States whose sole function is inspiration and praise. That's what it does. Nobody lives in it. Nobody works in it. Nobody does anything in it. Its sole purpose is inspiration and praise. And that is the Washington Monument in Washington, D.C. A giant obelisk stands 50 stories tall between the Capitol and the Lincoln Memorial and the Jefferson Memorial in the White House, a perfect cross. It has no other function than to lift our gaze heavenward. It is to inspire praise for the greatest American and to elevate our vision. Now, let me share a couple of details with you about the Washington Monument that I think are worth noting. First of all, the monument is freestanding, meaning that there is no cement or mortar holding together the 36,000 blocks. No cement, no mortar. It is literally a pile of rocks. The monument required 50 years to plan, raise the money, and build. The cornerstone was laid July 4th, 1948, 5 years after this church's first building was built. From 1854 to 1876, no construction was done whatsoever. Why? Because they ran out of money. It stood 150 feet tall. It just stood there for 22 years during the Civil War. If you see pictures of Washington, D.C., the Washington Monument is just a stub. And it stood that way for 22 years until they could get some money and the Civil War was over. The monument was at last completed in 1884 when a small aluminum cap was placed at the monument's pinnacle and dedicated on Washington's birthday, February. It was a cold, snowy day that day. When completed, the Washington Monument was the tallest building in the world till the Eiffel Tower was built 5 years later. There are four steps shy of 900 steps to the top. And by act of Congress, no building in Washington, D.C. can be taller. Now let me take a moment to focus on that aluminum cap I talked about that crowns the Washington Monument. Upon that cap are engraved two words written in Latin that face the eastern horizon. When the sun shines, when the sun comes up every morning, the first thing the sunlight touches are those two words. The two Latin words are Laus Deo. Laus Deo. Can anyone dust off your high school Latin to translate these two words for us? There it is. Praise God. This is the message that faces heaven from the highest point of our nation's capital, Laus Deo, praise God. It's the first thing the sunlight touches each morning. Praise God. And it reflects the spiritual conviction of our country's first and greatest president, George Washington. By the way, have you ever read George Washington's Prayer for America? Let me read it to you now. Almighty God, we make our earnest prayer that you will keep the United States in thy holy protection, that you will incline the hearts of its citizens to cultivate a spirit of subordination and obedience to government, and to entertain a brotherly affection and love for one another and for our fellow citizens. Finally, that you will most graciously be pleased to move us to do justice, to love mercy, and to humble ourselves with the charity, humility, and patience which were the characteristics of the divine author of our blessed religion, without whose example we can never hope to be a happy nation. Grant our prayer, we beseech you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Wow. Boy, we need the spirit of this prayer in our country today. Amen? Obedience to government. Do we need some obedience to government? Yeah. Brotherly affection for our fellow citizens. Do we need some brotherly affection for people who disagree with us politically? Oh my, yes. To humble ourselves with charity, humility, and patience. If this prayer were prayed today by President Biden, the ACLU would file suit. Obviously, George Washington was a man who believed that God would and could do great things for those who would trust God enough to obey him, to do the things that God blesses, for those who would praise God in the good times, and even more especially, praise God in the bad times. Laus Deo. Praise God. Now, let me tell you something that you all know. Praise is essential for those who would be spiritually healthy. This is why we make a point of starting every worship service with an act of praise. Glory be to the Father and to the Son. What are we doing? Laus Deo. We're praising God. That's what we're doing. We're praising God at the beginning of our worship service. Praise affirms that worship is not about us. Don't come in here and say, oh, God, I want this, I need this, I'm hurting, I'm blah, blah. No, you come in here, praise God. Praise you, Lord, in the good times, praise you in the bad times. Praise you when things are going my way, praise you when they aren't. I praise you, Lord, not because my health is good, I praise you because you, Lord, are worthy. It's not about us. It's about God. Praise requires that you let go of the me for the sake of the he. Praise is not about how good or bad your circumstances may be. It's all about how good we believe our God to be. Praise is the supreme act of faith because no matter how bad things get, our praise affirms our trust that God is good and that God works all things together for the good. Praise is essential for spiritual health. Those of you who grumble, who like to complain about this and that, who have a critical spirit, who have eyes only for what is wrong and no voice for what is right, you will never be spiritually healthy. You will never climb to the top of the spiritual mountain with Jesus. You will not know the power and the glory of the Holy Spirit. Such wonders are reserved for people of praise. For people who come to worship on Sunday morning, no matter how difficult the trials they face, and before doing anything else, lift their hearts and their voices to Almighty God in praise. Laus Deo. This is what our foremothers and fathers were trying to tell us when they put that aluminum cap with those two Latin words atop. Praise him. Praise him. And let me ask you a question. How many of you would like to know God's address? How many of you would like to know how to find your way to where God lives? Well, the scripture answers this question clearly when it tells us that God inhabits the praises of his people. Turn your Bibles to page 850. Psalm 22, verse 3. Psalm 22, verse 3. But you, Lord, are holy, enthroned in the praises of Israel. It says God is enthroned in the praises. In other words, our praises are the very throne of God. It's where God lives. So if you want to find God, if you want to go to where God lives, you praise him. Praise God in the good times. Praise God in the bad times. The Bible says that we are to offer the sacrifice of praise. Turn your Bibles to page 1,848. 1,848. Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13, verse 15. Therefore, by God, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. You know, sometimes it is a sacrifice. Sometimes you come in here on Sunday morning and think, you know, you're sick, your job is in jeopardy, and your wife or your husband has just ripped you again. And you come in here, and about the last thing you want to do is to praise the Lord. And that's when it becomes a sacrifice of praise. I mean, isn't this the first thing that King David did when his newborn child with Bathsheba died? When David was told that his child was dead, what did he do? How did he respond? Well, he washed his tears, anointed himself, changed his clothes, and went into the temple to do what? To praise God. That is a spiritually mature response. What was it that the Apostle Paul and Silas did when they were arrested in Philippi and thrown into stocks of a rat-infested jail? Well, turn your Bibles to page 1,708. 1,708, Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16, verse 24. Having received a charge, the jailer put Paul and Silas into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. Right now, I'd be crying my eyes out. Where's mom? But that's not what Paul and Silas did. Verse 25, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. In other words, what were they doing? They were praising the Lord. There's talks. It says the inner prison. That would be a nasty place. And at midnight, at the midnight hour, when things are at their worst, what are Paul and Silas found doing? They are praising the Lord. Praising God in the tough times is a pure expression of faith. It communicates to God that you trust him, that you believe in what God is doing. I don't understand it, God. I don't understand, but I trust you. And I praise you. And I submit myself to you. People all over the world are looking for God. They want to enter his throne room so that they can grumble and complain about how hard and unfair their life has been and about what they think God can do to make it all right and how God should run the world. But God does not reside at the place called complaint. He doesn't live on Grumbling Street. He lives on number one Praise Avenue. Amen. So praise him. Praise him in the good times. Praise him in the bad. Praise him when you're happy. Praise him when you're sad. But what do you do when you don't feel like it? We've all been there, amen? But the last thing we want to do is praise the Lord. But praise has nothing to do with how you feel. Praise isn't a matter of feelings. It's a matter of willing. Praise isn't about what you feel. It's about what you decide. Just because you don't feel like it doesn't mean that God is no longer worthy of it. Whether or not you feel like it or not, God still lives at the same address. Number one, Praise Avenue. I know some of you are suspicious, if not cynical. You think it's madness to praise God when life is at its worst. Well, how's the way you're doing it working for you? How's complaining and grumbling working for you? How's cynicism working for you? Praise God and see if God doesn't show up. When is the last time you really sincerely praised the Lord? Not for the good life you have, not for the health you enjoy. When was the last time you praised God for being God, for being holy, just, and true, for being gracious, kind, patient? This is where God lives. The temple he inhabits, Laus Deo. 200 years ago, a young French scholar named Alexandre de Tocqueville came to America to find out what made America great. He examined America's land, her government, her businesses, and her institutions. And at the end of his study, he concluded that the true strength and genius of America lay in her houses of worship. And this is still true today. America is great because her people are good, and the goodness of her people are forged in the praise of her worship. Let's bow our heads for words of prayer. Lord, we praise you. Not because we feel like it. We praise you, not because everything's going right. We praise you, not because we all agree. We praise you, Lord, not because it's easy. We praise you, Lord, not because the world is at peace. We praise you, Lord, because you are worthy. You are our God, and we bow before you in worship and praise. Bless you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In your name and by your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. last Sunday, we received 10 individuals in the church membership. That's a sacred promise by our church to be there. So I'd like to present each a new member with a membership certificate. And I'd like to introduce them each one by one. First, Melissa Grieve. Melissa is my neighbor. And Melissa is a newly, freshly retired attorney. And she is a gardener, among other things. And she owns the handsomest black lab I've ever seen. Why don't we welcome Melissa? Franklin and Cindy Myers, would you please come forward? Franklin's been coming to this church for the last 10 months, and he has worked and worked and worked, as has his wife Cindy, worked and worked and worked to make his life whole and healthy. It's hard work. He's working two jobs. He's working all night making shovels over Ames, and then he goes and washes dishes at Denny's. And he does that, and he does that, and he does that, and he does that. And he comes here, he goes to worship, and then he goes out to work. He works, and he works, and he works. All to just hold together. Life is not easy. But we're proud of you, Franklin. You know something? Is there anybody here who has not made some serious mistakes in life? Raise your hand if you've never made any serious mistake. You're among friends. Jackie Klein. Jackie and I met at a bar the other day. Jackie and I actually, we went to rival high schools. Jackie went to Central Dolphin and I went to Central Dolphin East. We were aware of each other. Jackie was a state wrestler and he wrestled varsity at Pitt. And 145?
126.
That was a while ago, huh? But Jackie has been a businessman and his business has taken him all over the world. There's probably not a place that you can mention that he hasn't been there. And he lives just right behind the Turkey Hill on, what's the name of that street? Wurzel Road, right? And Jackie, we're delighted to have you as a member. Would Carol and Jeannie please come forward together at this time? Now, these two, Carol and Jeannie, are the two most extroverted. They love attention. They want to be in front all the time. They're always fighting to get in front of everybody. Right, Jeannie?
Right.
Jeannie, how do you like your last name pronounced?
Mouts.
Mouts. Jeannie Mouts.
Yeah, what do you say?
My mistake. My bad. And Carol Smatters. Wait, Carol and Jean worshiped with me at Bachman United Methodist Church. But when Carol found out that I was coming here to training, she said, I mean, you're 3 minutes from my house. So she decided to come here, and we are delighted to have you. These are both very, very smart, capable administrators. They're very organized. God, I need them. I'm delighted that you're here. Now, Nancy Palmer, would you please come forward at this time? Now, Nancy Palmer first came here about weeks ago.
June 5th.
June 5th, about 5 weeks ago. And, you know, I honestly don't know a whole lot about you, except for I know this. Nancy is warm-hearted. She is passionate. She likes to pray. When I call her, she always picks up the phone, and she always has a good word to say. And I am looking forward to discovering who you are and who God wants you to be.
Well, right now I'm a retired person, and I'm homebound. I have no job. When I really do want to love the Lord, I want to love my question about it.
Well, we're delighted to have you. Give a welcome. Brian and Michelle Vaughn. I saw Brian up there. There he is. Brian, let's come forward.
Sorry, guys. No Winston today.
No Winston today.
Yeah, such a disappointment.
Brian and Michelle Vonk. Brian is an engineer, and he's got an engineering mind. He thinks very logically, sequentially, systematically. And his bride, Michelle, is an administrative leader over at the Hershey Hospital, the medical complex, and she basically helps with organizing and securing research projects for the physicians who are doing, you know, cutting edge research over at Hershey Medic. Together, they have a son by the name of Winston, and Winston is 3 years. Winston 3 years.
He's two.
Okay. And right now, Brian and Michelle are enjoying the visit of Michelle's parents. And so we're delighted to have you, Brian. God bless you. And we pray that we are worthy. Oh, my God. Some of you will remember. He's a great big man. He's about 6'5". He showed up for worship for the first time last Sunday. And when I said, those of you who are ready to join the church, he shot up and he came forward. I wasn't going to refuse him. Now, here's a guy who's homeless. He came to church on Sunday with his family. They have four adults, Chris, his daughter, her husband, and Chris's son, two dogs, a hound dog and a pit bull, and two little children, a four-year-old and an 18-month-old, they're living in a truck. Now, that's part of America. And our job is just not to just feel sorry for them and just give them whatever you want. It's not our job. Our job is to help him ultimately make a personal, life-giving connection with the one who will supply all his needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. Have we helped him? Yeah, we paid for a night, two nights of lodging for he and his family. And we helped him secure some contacts with people. He has since got the job. He's got two jobs, and now he's with Frank. He's working two jobs. So is his son-in-law. So he's not here this morning because he's working. He's working at Wendy's. These are some of the people who are walking through our door. And everybody that I know comes through that door for the first time. They don't come here by accident. They come here because something's going on in their life. And something is serious enough for them to drive them to go to church on Sunday. So anytime you see somebody new, Joan, when you see somebody sitting in front of you that you've never seen before, they're there for a reason. Something's going on. They're going through a divorce. They've just gotten laid off from their job. Their teenager is driving them stark raving wacko. They're in financial distress. They just moved. Something is upsetting enough that it's driving them to seek God's help. So not, you know, anytime you see a new visitor, it's not casual. Something's going on. And our job is to find out, our job is to welcome them enthusiastically. And then to figure out what they need and help them get it. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord cause the space to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and give you peace now and forevermore. I see blue skies because the sun always shines. A tribute to that Baptist Church. God bless you all.